بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن ولا هم بعد. This is our 21st lesson going through the book الشمائل المحمدية authored by أبو عيسى محمد بن عيسى بن سورة الترمذي رحمه الله تعالى. الحمد لله, we have arrived at the chapter باب ما جاء في خلق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, that which has come regarding the character and the traits of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from a character perspective. We've taken in a previous lesson بَابُ مَا جَاءَ فِي خَلْقِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, that which has come regarding the creation and the physical traits and the physical features and the physical characteristics of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in this chapter the author will discuss the spiritual and behavioral traits of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that indeed he was a man of utmost character, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described him in the Quran. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And so this is the asl, right, that all of these ahadith are going to revolve around. It is going to show us in detail the character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
The author says, حدثنا عباس بن محمد الدوري حدثنا عبد الله بن يزيد المقرئ ثقة حدثنا الليث بن سعد الإمام ثقة حدثني أبو عثمان الوليد بن أبي الوليد الوليد بن عثمان وهو لين الحديث عن سليمان بن خارجة أي سليمان بن خارجة the son of سليمان بن خارجة بن زيد بن ثابت وهو مجهول, and he's the reason why the hadith is weakened. عن خارجة بن زيد بن ثابت قال دخل نفر على زيد بن ثابت رضي الله عنه فقالوا له حدثنا أحاديث رسول الله, وفي نسخة قالوا حدثنا عن حديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, قال ماذا أحدثكم, كنت جاره فكان إذا نزل عليه الوحي بعث إلي فكتبته له, فكنا إذا ذكرنا الدنيا ذكرها معنا, وإذا ذكرنا الآخرة ذكرها معنا, وإذا ذكرنا الطعام ذكره معنا, فكل هذا أحدثكم عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So here, Zayd ibn Thabit, a group of individuals entered upon him, and they asked him to tell us about the Messenger and some speech with regards to what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And so, Zayd ibn Thabit mentioned, what do you want me to tell you about? And then he mentioned some points that I used to be his neighbor, and whenever the Quran would be revealed upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would call me to come and write the wahi. As we know, the Messenger of Allah, he had many scribes, and from the most prominent scribes was of course Zayd ibn Thabit. And of course, after the Messenger of Allah passed away, the one who was held responsible of collecting the Quran, أول من جمع القرآن بعد وفاة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, Zayd ibn Thabit رضي الله عنه وأرضاه. Right, and he's of course أعلم الناس بالحلال والحرام كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. لا قال أفرضكم سيد أعلم الناس بالفرائض أعلم الناس بالحرام معاذ بن جبل أصف أفرضكم زيد نعم أعلم الناس بالفرائض نعم دخل نفر على زيد بن ثابت رضي الله عنه. And so they asked him, حدثنا أحاديث رسول الله, قال ماذا أحدثكم, كنت جاره فكان إذا نزل عليه الوحي بعث إلي فكتبته له, فكنا إذا ذكرنا الدنيا ذكرها معنا. So this is محل الشاهد, that when we would sit with the Messenger of Allah in gatherings, when we would speak about the dunya, he would also mention it with us. And when we would speak about the akhirah, he would also mention it with us. And when we would speak about food and drink, he would also mention it with us. فَكُلُّ هَذَا وَحَدِّثْكُمْ. So I'm going to tell you about all of these things from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so the reason why Tirmidhi is bringing this hadith under this chapter is to show the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam how he was in gatherings. We mentioned some of these points in the previous lesson. But the mahallu shahir here is that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, despite being the central figure in that gathering, he would go with the flow, as they say today, right? He wouldn't force the gathering into whatever he wanted. لا. Rather, if he would enter a gathering or join a sitting or join a gathering, he would what? He would let the gathering flow and he would join in that which was khair, right? And so if they were speaking about the dunya, the Messenger of Allah would join in. He wouldn't change the topic, right? He wouldn't force a change to the topic. Rather, he would let the conversation flow, right? And this is great etiquette. Right, many people lack this etiquette when it comes to gatherings, or that they want the gathering to go their way, they want the gathering to go
with regard to whatever they want, right? And they give little care to everybody else, so they give little time for anybody else to speak or for anybody else to have any input, right? And we'll see, inshallah, the theme of these ahadith is as follows. The main theme that we're going to glean from these ahadith is that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his character shone the most in places where generally you find people slipping up with regard to their character, right? You find people who in these types of situations slip up and they fall into error with regard to their character. The Messenger of Allah was not like that, and that's why he is upon what? The highest level of character, right? وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Yeah, and we're going to see this inshallah, we see it here as well. One of the places in which people's characters slip up is during gatherings, when there's a conversation occurring, whether it be online or in person, right? You're in a group and you're conversing, right? And either you're talking too much, or you're not letting other people speak, or you are unable to carry or hold a conversation that is beneficial, right? You fall into sins whilst conversing, sins that you could potentially well avoid, right? And so these things are all what? You start backbiting, start slandering in these gatherings, right? You start talking vain talk. And these things are min khawarim al-akhlaq. They denigrate a person's character. So this is a place in which your character is tested. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed that test with flying colours, as Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu in Tata mentions in this hadith. Tayyib, Allahu alam. The author then says, حدثنا إسحاق بن موسى قال حدثنا يونس بن بكير عن محمد بن إسحاق بن يسار عن زياد بن أبي زياد عن محمد بن كعب بن القرظي عن عمرو بن العاص رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقبل بوجهه وحديثه على أشر القوم يتألفهم بذلك فكان يقبل بوجهه وحديثه علي حتى ظننت أني خير القوم فقلت يا رسول الله أنا خير أم أبو بكر فقال أبو بكر فقلت يا رسول الله أنا خير أم عمر قال عمر فقلت يا رسول الله أنا خير أم عثمان فقال عثمان فلما سألت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فصدقني فلا وددت أني لم أكن أني لم أكن سألته. And so this hadith, you find that Amr ibn al-As رضي الله عنه, he mentioned that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he used to speak directly and hold conversations with the most wretched of the people, the worst of the people, the lowest of the people. يَتَأَلَّفُهُمْ بِذَلِكَ. And the reason why he would do so is to try and win their hearts. So he would speak to them in a manner, in a soft manner, in a manner that would allow them, and he would speak to them in an attentive manner and turn his face completely towards them, which was a point that we mentioned in the previous lesson, right? يَتَأَلَّفُهُمْ بِذَلِكَ. And the reason why is that he wanted to win their hearts. وَكَانَ يُقْبِلُ بِوَجِهِ وَحَدِيثِهِ عَلِيَّ. And he used to do this with me. And as we know, Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu, initially he opposed Islam. And we know the famous incident that he had with Ja'far ibn Abi Talib in the presence of al-Najashi. And Amr ibn As was from the leaders of Bani Sahm, which is his tribe, that they used to oppose the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He fought and waged war against the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hatta aslam. And then when he entered into Islam, بعد صلح الحديبية, before Fath Makkah, he thought that he would be he would be treated in a way that wouldn't be the same as the others, and that he wouldn't receive this attention from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yet he did. In fact, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him as the leader of armies that included the best of the companions, and he put him in charge. Right, he sent him to the Qabil of Dudam in Ma'raka that is Salasil. Right, in the 7th year of the Hijrah, he sent Amr ibn al-As as the commander. And he had underneath his command the famous companions that are mentioned in this hadith, Abu Bakr and Umar. Right? And so when he came back, he thought that the Messenger of Allah has put me in charge of his most closest companions. He's also speaking to me in a manner that I never thought he would speak to me with. Right? Speaking to me in a way that is completely attentive to me when I visit him and when I sit with him. يُقْبِلْ بِوَجْهِهِ. He turns his face completely towards me. Despite things that Amr ibn al-As had done against Islam earlier on. And so this gave Amr ibn al-As the confidence to think, oh, I must be someone who is what? Very close to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in terms of seniority.
And so he asked him these questions. And of course, this question is found in the Sahih. من أحب الناس إليك؟ قالت عائشة. The best of Allah said عائشة. And then he asked, what about from the men? قال أبوها. And then who after that? فعد رجال. And he mentioned some men. And this hadith comes in a more explicit manner than that hadith, which is more مجمل. Right? And so when Amr ibn al-As saw the interaction that the Messenger of Allah was having with him, and the trust that the Messenger of Allah had in Amr ibn al-As, in that he would allow him to lead armies, allow him and send him as a wali of Uthman, right, and send him as the person to collect zakat from the, remember that famous incident of Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, where he was sent alone, one man, by himself to Uthman, right, and he was able to conquer Uthman by himself, one man, to collect the zakat and get them into Islam and then remain firm upon al-Islam radiallahu anhu arda. And so this trust that the Messenger of Allah had in him gave Amr ibn al-As the confidence to think, oh, I might be the best of people here, despite being coming so late, right, into Islam. And so he asked the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ana khayr Abu Bakr. And here you can see the list that he mentions, because he knew that these are the senior companions, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, which is mutawatir and well known, that these companions were the foremost companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who had been there through the times of difficulty, through the times of hardship and so on. And so he compared himself to them, because these are the standard, they are the standard, but they were under me and I was their commander, and so maybe I'm the Messenger of Allah sees me as a person who's equal to them or better than them. فقلت له وسوست يا رسول الله أنا خير أم أبو بكر أم better or أبو بكر. And the Messenger of Allah replied, Abu Bakr. وهذا يدلك على الصدق. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, yes, يعني كان لا يكذب يصدق, yes, I will treat you in a way that is you are deserving of being treated. Yeah, right. I will turn my attention to you completely when we discuss matters and when we talk and when we meet, and I will give you the best of etiquette and the best of akhlaq. But when it comes to answering questions in a way that is haq, I will tell the haq. Right? And the Messenger of Allah, the haq is clear that Abu Bakr is senior and better than Amr ibn As. And then he said, Ana khayrun am Umar, am I better or Umar? Faqala Umar. And then am I better or Uthman? Faqala Uthman. Falamma sa'altu Rasulullah fasadaqani. And so when I asked the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told me the truth. وَهَذَا يَعْنِي مِنْ خُلُقِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Right? You have to speak the truth. Right? Speaking the truth. Right? As they say in the Christians, speak the truth and the truth shall set you free. Right? As they say. طيب. فَلَمَّا سَأَلْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَصَدَقَنِي فَلَوَرِدْتُ أَنِّي لَمْ أَكُنْ أَسْأَلَهُ أَنِّي لَمْ أَكُنْ سَأَلْتُ. That I wish I had not asked him, because here, Amr ibn al-As realized that he is not the most senior companion of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he came too late, right? And this is a regret that Amr ibn al-As had, that he did not come early. However, despite that, Amr ibn al-As still hasuna islamuhu, and we know the great feats that he achieved after the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam had passed away. And even during the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was given these positions of seniority despite him, in terms of comparisons to Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, he wasn't at their level. Yet he was still given these positions of power and authority because of the man that they knew he was and the da'iyah that he was, right? And of course, he was trusted by Abu Bakr, trusted by Umar, trusted by Uthman, trusted by Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, radhiyallahu alayhim ajma'in. طيب. And this hadith, this wording of it is, some ulama weakened this report due to the presence of Muhammad ibn Ishaq and his an'ana, and also the lean of Ziyad ibn Abi Ziyad. But as I said, the asl of this report, asl al-hadith is sahihain, is found in Bukhari and Muslim, the famous hadith, man ahabu an-nas ilay qala Aisha famin ar-rijal qala abuha thumma 'adda rijalan, right? Now, kama qala radiyallahu anhu. طيب. So again, here we see another point. Remember we said the theme that we're going to see in this chapter is that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we're going to see that his etiquettes and his character shines brightest in these positions and in these states and in these cases where you would expect someone's character to be affected, right? And you would expect someone's character to suffer from problems, right? We said that these ahadith will show us that the Messenger of Allah, even during these times where you expect someone's character to falter, he did not falter. Why? Because he's upon what? The highest form of moral conduct and the highest form of character, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wasafahu bithalika faqala jalla sha'nuhu wa innaka la'ala khuluqin azim. ذي وثن أنس حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد قال حدثنا جعفر بن سليمان الضبعي عن ثابت عن أنس بن مالك قال خدمت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم 10 سنين فما قال لي أف قط وما قال لي لشيء صنعته لما صنعته ولا لشيء تركته لما تركته. وكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أحسن الناس خلقا، ولا مسست خزا ولا حريرا ولا شيئا كان ألين من كف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولا شممت مسكا قط ولا عطرا كان أطيب من عرق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. This is the famous hadith of Anas رضي الله عنه في الصحيحين that he served the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم for 10 years. Umm Sulaym brought him as a 10-year-old boy to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he came to Medina. And she said that, I've given you my son that he serves you. And he served him for the rest of his life for 9 and a bit years. And yani some rounded up to 10. And so we see here, again, that point that I mentioned, which is a theme across this chapter, that you have the character of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shining through in places where you would expect individuals' characters to falter and to have problems. Right? How many of us, with our children or our employees, if you're a boss, we've lost a plot with them, right? When they make a mistake, we say what oof, or we say something even worse than that. Oof is just the lowest, the lowest level, meaning oof and anything above that. But it doesn't mean that the Messenger of Allah didn't say oof, but he said something else. لا. He never said even oof. That's what it's meant by فما قال لي شيئا أو فما قال لي oof قط. He never said to me, oof, meaning he never had a problem with a mistake that I fell into. And Anas then admits that I fell into mistakes by saying, وَمَا قَالَ لِي لِشَيْءٍ صَنَعْتُهُ لِمَا صَنَعْتُهُ. If I did something wrong, he never asked me, why did I do that? How many times does a child do something wrong and the first thing the mother or the father says, why did he do that? صح. The Messenger of Allah didn't have that. And this is with what? His servant. How many of us would lose our plot if we had a servant? How many of us lose a plot when we have a maid or you have someone cleaning the house or an employee that comes and does something? Right, we lose the plot. Right, we lose it with these people. Yet the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم never lost it with them. Right, وهذا من خلقه العظيم صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then the last part of the hadith is describing the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم with descriptions we come across before, that he was the finest of human being in character, and that he never felt any silk or like that. Right, that was more softer than the palm of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that he never smelled any musk or perfume more fragrant than the sweat of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right, ولا شممت مسكا قط ولا عطرا كان أطيب من عرق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. We spoke about these points before in previous lessons, but the محل الشاهد here is again you see how the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with his servants and how his character shone with regard to his servants and those who are lower than him in his home. And of course, if that's how the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم was with his servants, then how was he with his wives? He was also very similar in terms of softening his character towards his wives and towards his servants as well. صلى الله عليه وسلم. The author then says, حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد وأحمد بن عبدة هو الضبي والمعنى واحد, meaning they both reported this hadith and the meaning is the same even though if the love might be slightly different. قال, they both said, حدثنا حماد بن زيد عن سلم العلوي عن أنس بن مالك عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه كان عنده رجل به أثر صفرة. قال, وكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يكاد يواجه أحدا بشيء يكرهه, فلما قام قال للقوم لو قلتم له يدع هذه الصفرة. طيب, so here we have a man who used to wear, or who was in a gathering of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, wearing a form of yellow colored clothing, or wearing some form of clothing that had saffron on it. And the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم would not confront a person with something that he disliked. That was his habit. فلما قام, when the man stood up and left, قال للقوم, said to the rest of the people in the gathering, لو قلتم له يدع هذه الصفرة. Go and tell him, if only you told him, that he should let go and not use this saffron or this type of colored clothing. Now here, someone may ask, where is the character of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم here? Or what character is being espoused in this hadith? The khuluq here that's being espoused in this hadith is the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم's hikmah and knowledge of being able to know how to deal with certain individuals. And we see this clearly in another report, a similar report to this, that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he saw Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As رضي الله عنه, and he was wearing a similar type of clothing, a clothing that had some yellow next to it and had some saffron on it. فزجره النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the messenger of Allah confronted him and spoke to him in a what would be deemed a harsh manner to get him to what? To take off that clothing and to not wear it. طيب. Now, it's a similar situation that the messenger of Allah dealt it in two different ways. And the reason being is Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As is not like this man. طيب. Meaning this man, if the messenger of Allah was to confront him the way he confronted Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, he may object. And this objection might lead him into trouble, might lead him to kufr, might lead him to not accept Islam, right? And so, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam here is weighing up the masalih and the mafasid of him speaking out in the way that he would do with someone like Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. Because Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As would take this as an opportunity of what? As a lesson, as a benefit, his iman is rasikh, his iman is complete, he's a well-established Muslim, and he's able to take this type of talk from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the reason why we know that is because Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, he's the one who relayed that report and told us about this incident, because هذا فخر له, it's a manner of honor for him that the Messenger of Allah is correcting him. He takes it as a badge of honor, whereas others may not take it in that way. And it's something which we find today even in the workplace, as a boss or as an employer. No two employees are the same. One employee doesn't like being confronted with his mistakes, another person doesn't mind that. And so, the true employer, he what? He is able to put things in the right place. وَهَذِهِ مِنْ حِكْمَةِ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. From the wisdom of the Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And so, if he said to the people, why didn't you go and tell them you went and told him to not do that? Meaning, the people might have better access to the individual than the Messenger صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And if they tell him that the Messenger of Allah told them, he might be what? More accepting. And that he hasn't been blasted in the gathering. Imagine now, you're in a gathering and you blast somebody for making a mistake in public. How would he react to that? And that's an important point as well. Right? When you're giving advice to somebody, are you going to blast them online on social media? Or are you going to take them aside and correct them? Some people like to be blasted. Right? They if they're blasted in public, it's something which what is yani, useful to them. Whereas others, it's not. Rather, it's detrimental to them. And so you've got to be able to figure these out, and figure these things out, and be able to put everything in its right place. طيب. And this is something which requires experience. You're not going to get it right the first time. It requires experience. However, as we know, the Messenger of Allah is different to us in terms of his character. He is ala khuluqin azim. He is the peak, the epitome, the standard of moral conduct and moral character. So he knows how to deal with these things. As for us, it's training, something which requires wisdom, life experience. Right? Get it wrong the first time, get it wrong the second time, and then eventually, hopefully, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the ability to get it right. Right? And very seldom we will. Right? But the shahid here is that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was not from his habit to bluntly express things. And we notice in the other hadith, مَبَالُ أَقْوَامٍ, his admonishment was always general. He wouldn't specify it. Right? Some people make a mistake and he would generalize it in terms of his admonishment or his advice. مَبَالُ أَقْوَامٍ يَفْعَلُونَ كَذَا وَكَذَا. طيب. وَهَذَا مِنْ فِقْهِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَمِنْ خُلُقِهِ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. The author says, حَدَّثَنَا مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ بَشَّارٍ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ جَعْفَرٍ. Of course, here Muhammad ibn Bashar is Bundar. قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ جَعْفَرٍ غُنْدَر. قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا شُعْبَةُ عَنْ أَبِي إِسْحَاقَ السَّبِيعِ عن أبي عبد الله الجدلي واسمه عبد بن عبد عن عائشة أنها قالت لم يكن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فاحشا ولا متفحشا ولا صخابا في الأسواق ولا يجزئ بالسيئة السيئة ولكن يعفو ويصفح. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم is being described here by المؤمنين عائشة رضي الله عنها أعلم الناس به. It was not from his nature to talk in an indecent manner or engage in the use of obscene and vulgar language. Neither did he shout when he was in the bazaars or when he was in the marketplace. Neither did he avenge a bad deed with a bad one. Rather, he would forgive it and then not look at it afterwards and not mention it. Meaning, he would forgive and forget. Right? يتجاوز يعفو أي يتجاوز ويصفح أي يعرض. Right? من الصفح. He would forgive and forget. Live and let be. طيب. صلى الله عليه وسلم. And so here we see these descriptions that again tie into that general theme that I mentioned earlier, in that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was of great character, the highest level of moral conduct and character, and that this character shone the highest and shone the brightest and shone the most when he was in situations where you would expect a person's character to have what? To have flaws in. Right? For example, he heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not engage in vulgar talk. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not speak in a manner that is of an indecent way. He did not engage in the use of obscene language. Some people, they are indecent. Some people, they are they try their utmost best to speak in a vulgar manner to make people laugh. Right? Today, comedians, right? If you look at the ones who get the most views or the ones who get the most interactions, are the ones who joke about vulgar things, right? And incorporate vulgar material into their jokes, right? And into their content. However, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not in need of that, right? لم يكن فاحشا ولا متفاحشا, right? نعم. ولا صخابا في الأسواق. Likewise, the Messenger of Allah did not need to shout in the marketplace, right? He did not need to argue or haggle or speak in a loud tone when in the marketplace. And this is the place where you would expect people to shout, in the bazaars. You could go to a marketplace everywhere in the world, especially in the Arab world, and it's what a chaos. It's chaos. Right, everybody's trying to rip everybody else off, right? And it's a chaotic place to be. Yet the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was in the marketplace, he would not shout, he would not raise his tone, he would not speak in such manner. Rather, he would what? He would go about dealing with his business in a dignified manner. We know the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a businessman in terms of he worked for Khadija as a young man, right? And he would go on trading journeys to Asham, right? And he would engage in trade. And likewise in Medina, and when he was in Mecca, he would go into the marketplace and the bazaars and buy things, right? And so the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not be someone who would what? Who would raise his tone in the marketplace, or raise his voice in the marketplace, or argue with the people. And this shows us again, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had genuine moral conduct, right? It was not a show that he was putting on, right? Rather, in every single situation we see where you would expect someone's character to have holes in, he was what? Complete in his conduct, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Likewise, وَلَا يَجْزِئُ بِالسَّيِّئَةِ السَّيِّئَةِ وَلَكِنْ يَعْفُوا وَيَصْفَحَ. The Messenger of Allah would not reply a bad deed with a bad deed. If someone treated him unfairly or unjustly, he wouldn't treat them back with what? Unfairness or unjustness or injustice or oppress them. The Messenger of Allah was not like that. And of course, the Messenger of Allah كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ, as Aisha رَضُوَانَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهَا mentioned. We know in the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, in Surah Fussilat, right? قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلَ مِمَنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَلَا السَّيِّئَةُ إِدْفَعَ بِالَّتِي هي أحسن فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم. Likewise, Surah the next Surah, Surah Al-Shura, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وجزاء سيئة سيئة مثلها فمن عفا وأصلح فأجره على الله. Right? And so we see here that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took the better option. When he was treated unfairly by Quraysh, when he was oppressed by Quraysh and he came back victorious and he had the opportunity, he had the upper hand over them, what did he say to them? Did he take revenge? لا. بل قال لا تثريب عليكم اليوم يغفر الله لكم اذهبوا فأنتم الطلقاء. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, right, how he honored Abu Sufyan. من دخل دار أبي سفيان فهو آمن. Despite Abu Sufyan treating the Messenger of Allah the way that he did. Likewise, we see Amr ibn al-As رضوان الله عليه, who was from the oppressors. However, when he accepted Islam, the Messenger of Allah brought him close. وكان يقبل عليه, right, and he also sent him as leaders of the armies of the Muslimin. Likewise, Khalid ibn Walid and the other individuals who oppressed the Messenger and were unjust towards the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they accepted Islam, when they returned back to Allah subhanahu wa taala, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took them in with both hands, and accepted their pact, accepted their pledge of allegiance, and was the better person. Likewise, even with Wahshi, who killed the uncle of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? The Messenger of Allah forgave him. The Messenger of Allah forgave him, even though he didn't want to see his face because of he did not want to be reminded of the atrocity that Wahshi had committed. But despite that, he still forgave him and overlooked the sin that Wahshi had fallen into. طيب. And so we see here clearly the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not reply a bad deed with another bad deed. بل كان يعفو, he would forgive and he would let live as well, meaning forgive and forget.
صلى الله عليه وسلم. وهذا يدل عليه this shows us again the utmost character and conduct of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. The author then says حدثنا هارون بن إسحاق الحمداني قال حدثنا عبده عن هشام بن عروة عن أبيه عن عائشة قالت ما ضرب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بيده شيئا قط إلا أن يجاهد في سبيل الله ولا ضرب خادما ولا امرأة. That the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did not strike with the intent to cause harm anything with his hand except for when performing jihad في سبيل الله ولا ضرب خادما ولا امرأة. Likewise the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did not strike with the intention to cause harm a servant or a woman. طيب. And so we see here the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his character when it comes to dealing with women folk and his servants, the two weakest members in society along with children, that you don't need to treat them in such a manner where you need to hit them and intend to cause harm to them. Rather, you can get your point across without the need to do that. And of course we have fiqh guidelines when it comes to women who are disobedient, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, الرجال قوامون على النساء بما فضل الله بعضهم على بعض بما أنفقوا من أموالهم فالصالحات قانتات حافظات للغيب بما حفظ الله واللاتي تخافون نشوزهن فعظوهن وهجروهن في المضاجع واضربوهن فإن أطعنكم فلا تبغوا عليهن سبيلا. Likewise the hadith of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم فاضربوهن ضربا غير مبرح فإن أطعنكم فلا تبغوا عليهن سبيلا. وكما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, that's fiqh guidelines. That doesn't necessitate that the Messenger of Allah did it himself. These are guidelines that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, right? However, did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself hit a woman? لا. Now, that's one mas'ala. The second mas'ala is pertaining to the famous hadith, فَلَهَزَنِي فِي صَدْرِي فَوْجَعَتْنِي وَكَمَا قَالَتْ عَائِشَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا. Now that hitting that the Messenger of Allah did was not a hitting with the intent to cause harm. The hitting intended here, ما ضرب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بيده شيئا قط إلا أن يجاهد في سبيل الله. The hitting here that's intending is hitting to cause harm. Hitting with the intent to cause harm to the person who you are hitting. And that's clearly learned from the fact that she said إلا, with the exception here of أن يجاهد في سبيل الله. When the Messenger of Allah was performing jihad, he would hit with the intent to cause harm to the one who is hitting, because he's in jihad في سبيل الله. That's what's being intended here. The ضرب. However, the Messenger of Allah hit Abu Dharr on his shoulder. فضرب بيده على منكبي. Right, as it's come in the fifth hadith Sahih Muslim. Right. So the ضرب in those contexts is للتعليم وللتدريس, أو in order to grab the attention and that I'm going to mention to you something very important. So listen up. Right. And of course, فلا هزني في صدري فأوجعتني is a nudge, push. It wasn't a hitting, in the in the sense of striking. طيب. فلا هزني في صدري أوجعتني وكما قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها. And that's of course with the intent to not cause harm, the intent to not hit, but the intent to what? To grab attention. Right? The intent to grab attention. And so there is no تناقض in these two hadith. And there's no تعارض in between these two hadith. The first hadith is the ما ضرب رسول الله, i.e. with the intent to cause harm, with the intent to inflict pain and harm upon the person you are hitting. And that's not what's intended in the hadith of فلا هزني في صدري. طيب. And the context of the hadith clearly mentions that, because the Messenger of Allah did that with the intent of grabbing her attention to get her ready to listen to an important dua or an important dhikr that the Messenger of Allah was about to tell her. طيب. So we see here from this hadith that the Messenger of Allah did not abuse, did not hit with the intent to cause harm a woman or a servant. And we see people today, when it comes to their women, they hit with the intent of what? Causing harm, actual harm to their servant, right? They see their servant making a mistake or making an error, or their wife making a mistake or making the error, and they reward that error with what? With abuse. They hit them and they hurt them, and it really goes up over and beyond what is required. And they will do it to a wife who's normally obedient, who's not even a nashiza. Right, she's an obedient wife who helps him and supports him in everything. But because she made a mistake here, she didn't do something right here, he goes overboard and starts to hit her and abuse her, right? And hit her black and blue. That's not the role of a man. That's not what a man does, right? Rather, the man should be like the messenger and have the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as his role model. أَنَّهُ لَمْ يَكُنْ يَضْلِبُ خَادِمًا وَلَمْ رَأَةً قَطُّهُ. طيب, هذا والله أعلم. The author says, حدثنا أحمد بن عبدة الضبي قال حدثنا فضيل بن عياض عن منصور عن الزهري عن عروة عن عائشة قالت ما رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم منتصرا من مظلمة ظلمها قط ما لم ينتهك من محارم الله تعالى شيء، فإذا انتهك من محارم الله شيء كان من أشدهم في ذلك غضبا، وما خير بين أمرين إلا اختار أيسرهما ما لم يكن مأثما. And so here we see the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha radiallahu anha, she mentions that the Messenger of Allah would not take revenge for an outrage or a transgression that had been committed against him, as long as the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were not violated. Remember here, every single man with character has to have a mabda, has to have principles that you can't go, that you cannot violate. And if these principles are violated, then you have to stand up. A man with no principles is a man with no character. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's principles were maharimullahi subhanahu, that we do not violate the legislation of Allah azza wa jal. You can go commit an act of transgression against myself, and you can have a personal problem with me. And if you have a personal problem with me, then I will, as we mentioned previously, idfa billati hiya ahsan. Right? فَمَنْ عَفَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. That's when it comes to me and you personal dealings, personal problems. You personally cause a problem for me. This is where those masail come into play. But when the maharim of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are violated, when the sacred legislation and prohibitions of Allah, when the limits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set is violated, then our principles have been violated. And there is no, let's be soft, let's be this, la la la. فإذا انتهك من محارم الله شيء كان من أشدهم في ذلك غضبا. As Aisha mentioned, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the sacred violation, when the sacred prohibitions and the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were violated, he would be enraged. He would be the most angry of the people. Why? Because the principles have been violated. طيب. And this is something that shows us again the conduct of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when it comes to the religion, when it comes to the deen, when it comes to the message, there is no playing about. There is no, space to be given to these people who violate the laws of Allah. La la la. When the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are violated, we have to stand up against this. طيب. And we have to show that we have to stand up against this. Right? You can't just sit there and take it on the chin. La la la. طيب. Islam is not a religion that is like that. طيب. We do not turn the other cheek when our principles are violated. Abadan. طيب. And so that's very important. So as a man, you have to be a man of principles. If you want to be a man with good character, you have to be a man with principles. طيب. And the Messenger of Allah was that. وَمَا خُيِّرَ بَيْنَ أَمْرَيْنِ إِلَّا اخْتَارَ أَيْسَرُهُمَا مَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مَأْثَمَا. Again, you see the central part of the character of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was his deen, was his religion. So when it comes to choosing between two affairs, the standard is the religion. If the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if the deen of Allah, the legislation of Allah was not going to be violated by choosing the easy option, then he would choose the easy option. But if choosing the easier option will lead to a violation of the laws of Allah, then he would not take the easier option. Right? مَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مَأْثَمَا. Provided that this choice was not conducive to sin, he would choose the easier of the two. Whenever a matter would be brought forth to him. And again, this shows us the fact that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a man of principles. And that these principles could not be violated. If they were violated, then the Messenger of Allah would react to that. But if you went against him in a personal matter, right? Methalan, you went against the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a personal matter, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would not react in a negative way. And the classic example of the famous rabbi who wanted to test the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's hilm, wanted to test the Messenger of Allah's forbearance. And so he uttered some rude words to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? And he said that you children of Bani Abdul Muttalib, you are known to be people who do not pay their debts, right? That you are known to be people who don't pay their debts. And so Umar ibn Khattab became angry because he had spoken evil of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, yet the Messenger of Allah's hilm came out, right? His forbearance came out. And that's of course why? Because the violation that this individual committed was a violation against what? The Messenger of Allah personally. He personally attacked the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And of course, personally attacking the Messenger of Allah is what? After his death, it's what? It's kufr billah azza wa jal. For you to say what that individual said, if the Messenger of Allah was not available, if someone today said what that individual said to the Messenger of Allah, he'd be a kafir. He'd be a kafir, right? Right, because that's intiqasun li nabiyyi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, when the Messenger of Allah is alive and someone attacks him personally, then he has the option of forgiving. He has the option of forgiving sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so he forgave and he was the better man. And that's an example and an application of the other ahadith we took and the ayat that we took as well, that we mentioned a couple of ahadith ago. But when it comes to the maharim of Allah, when it comes to the laws of Allah being violated, the Messenger of Allah would get angry and he would ensure that these violations were dealt with in the sound and proper way. طيب والله أعلم.
The author then says, حدثنا ابن أبي عمر قال حدثنا سفيان عن محمد بن المنكدر عن عروة عن عائشة قالت استأذن رجل على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وأنا عنده فقال بئس ابن العشيرة أو أخو العشيرة ثم أذن له فلما دخل فألان له القول فلما خرج قلت يا رسول الله قلت ما قلت ثم أرنت له القول فقال يا عائشة إن من شر الناس من تركه الناس أو ودعه الناس اتقاء فحشه. So here, Aisha radiallahu anha mentions that that a man sought permission to enter into the presence of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she was with him, i.e. with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَقَالَ, and so the Messenger of Allah said, بِئْسَ بْنُ الْعَشِيرَةِ أَوَخُ الْعَشِيرَةِ. What a wretched member of his community this individual is, meaning this man who's going to enter upon the Messenger of Allah is. ثُمَّ أَذِنَ لَهُ, and then he allowed him to enter. فَلَمَّا دَخَلَ, when the man entered, أَلَنَّ لَهُ الْقَوْلِ, meaning the Messenger of Allah spoke to him in a gentle and soft manner. فَلَمَّا خَرَجَ, when he exited, قَالَتْ عَائِشَةَ said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قُلْتَ مَا قُلْتُ, you said what you said, ثُمَّ أَلَنْتَ لَهُ الْقَوْلَ, and then you were soft with him in your speech. فَقَالَ يَا عَائِشَةَ أَوْ عَائِشَةَ إِنَّ مِنْ شَرِّ النَّاسِ مَنْ تَرَكَهُ النَّاسُ أَوْ وَدَعَهُ النَّاسُ اتِّقَاءَ فُحْشِهِ. And so here we see an example of a concept known as al-mudarah, a concept in the sharia known as al-mudarah. And al-Bukhari rahimahullah has a chapter in his kitab known as in his sahih bab al-mudarah, bab al-mudarati min al-nas. Nah. And then he mentions the report from Abi Darda, I believe, or Abi Qatada. Allahu alam at the moment, I can't remember. But you remember he mentions a report that we will smile in a person's face whilst in our hearts we are cursing them. And this is based on the hadith. So this is taken from this hadith. إِنَّ مِنْ شَرِّ النَّاسِ مَنْ تَرَكَهُ النَّاسُ وَدَعَهُ النَّاسُ وَدِقَاءَ فُحْشِهِ. From the worst of mankind are those whom you avert from their evil, or you protect yourself from their evil, right, by avoiding them. And so you use avoiding tactics, smiling at them, talking to them in a gentle manner, in order to protect yourself from their fush. Because if you speak to them one word in a bad way, they're going to throw all of their evil, their vulgar and their obscene language upon you, right? Nah. And so this is a similar case in this hadith, where this individual enters or seeks permission to enter upon the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was known as a fasiq, a rebellious sinner, an open sinner, someone who publicized his sins, and he was a person of vulgarity and obscenity, right? And some ulama mentioned that he's referring to Uyaynah ibn Hisn al-Fazari, who was a Bedouin, right? And apostated after death of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then eventually came back to Islam. But he was a person who had these harsh characteristics, harsh mannerisms, a person of vulgarity. طيب. And so this person entered or sought permission to enter into the presence of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so the Messenger of Allah described him as, what a wretched representation, what a wretched person of your community you are. And so this is kalamun, which is what? To warn the people against this individual's conduct and behavior, right? And that this person isn't a person who you should look up to or look for inspiration with regard to their conduct or their moral way. So the Messenger of Allah is warning the people, and this is not ghibah. Why? Because this person's what? A person who was exposing his sins publicly. وَالْمُجَاهِرُ بِمَعْصِيَتِهِ لَا غِيبَةَ فِيهِ. There is no such thing as backbiting someone who is publicizing their sins, and you're refuting them for that sin that they've fallen into in terms of their publicization of their sins. However, when you come into contact with them, right,
it may not be wise for you to berate them in public. In terms of, it may not be wise to berate them in their presence. Why? Because of their evil conduct or their evil mannerisms or their vulgarity or obscenity, they might make the situation doubly worse or even worse. Right? You say to them one bad word, and they're going to reply back with 10 bad words, and they'll fall into what potential, potentially even worse or a more worse situation than they were in before. Right? And they might even remain more firm on their misguidance and their sin, right, than before you even spoke to them with an element of harshness. And so the Messenger of Allah employed this concept of al-mudarah. When the man came in, he spoke to him in a polite manner, in order for the man to think, oh, I need to change. If this is the Messenger of Allah, the best of creation, and he's speaking to me in this manner, in this gentle way, this should be what? A light bulb moment for me to go back and think, oh, he treated me in that way. I should also think about my situation and try to rectify my problem and try to come back to my senses and come back to the haqq and leave off the vulgarity and the obscene language and things that I used to do, right? And so this is mubab al-mudarah. And likewise, the Messenger of Allah is avoiding this person's evil through this good speech. By you speaking good to somebody, you won't expect to get vulgarity back. And that's something which is natural. When you speak good to people, you'll get good back. Right? Now, and so the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam employed this tactic in order to bring him closer. However, along with that, he's also warning the rest of mankind, the rest of the people, from this individual's conduct at that very time. And that's, of course, bayan al-haq, clarifying the truth. As we mentioned in the previous hadith of the Messenger of Allah, ما كان ينتصر من مظلمة ظلمها قط ما لم ينتهك محارم الله وما لم ينتهك من محارم الله. You see? And so when the sacred violation, oh, when the sacred law of Allah was violated, the Messenger of Allah clarified the haqq. Like here, بِئْسَ إِبْنُ الْعَشِرَ أَخُ الْعَشِرَ. Why? Because this person was kind of mujahir, used to expose and publicize his sins. However, when it comes to dealing with this individual on a one-on-one basis, then the tactics that are used to try to bring him back to the haqq has to be through what? Al-leen. وَلَوْ فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. طيب فعفو عنهم. وَاسْتَغْفِرِ لَهُمْ وَشَاوِرُهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. Right? And so the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was with these people who had that kind of mannerisms and that kind of conduct, the Messenger of Allah sought to rectify their problem with what? Or rectify their situation with what? With soft speech. طيب أُدْعُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنَ. Argue with that which is better. طيب. And that's very important for us too. To note. طيب الله أعلم. The author حدثنا سفيان بن وكيع قال حدثنا جميع بن عمير بن عبد الرحمن العجلي حدثني رجل من بني تميم من ولد أبي هالة زوج خديجة رضي الله عنها يكنى أبا عبد الله عن ابن لأبي هالة عن الحسن بن علي قال الحسين بن علي. So this is the third time we've come across this hadith. We came across it in yesterday's lesson, and we came across it, I believe, in the second lesson of this series. Right, the famous hadith of Al-Hasan, and this time the author will discuss it from the angle of Al-Husayn ibn Ali radiyallahu anhu. Qala Al-Husayn radiyallahu anhu. Qala Al-Husayn ibn Ali radiyallahu anhu. Huma sa'altu abi an sirati Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi julasaihi. I asked my father about the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and how the Messenger of Allah conducted himself when he was in his gatherings. فقال علي رضي الله عنه كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دائما البشري أي دائما البشاشة. That the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was always good humored, right? Likewise, سهل الخلق. Likewise, the Messenger of Allah was very easy going. ولين الجانب أي سريع العطف. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم was mild mannered, meaning he was quick to make him joyful and happy. ليس بفظ ولا غليظ. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was neither rude nor was he coarse, as Allah سبحانه وتعالى mentioned him to not be that. فبما رحمة من الله لنت لهم. It is only by the mercy of Allah that you have indeed become soft to them. ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك. If you were hard-hearted, harsh, coarse towards them, they would have indeed fled from you. ولا صخاب, meaning لم يكن رجلا ذا شدة صوت. That the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was not a person who was boisterous, obscene in his speech. loud in his speech. طيب ولا فحاش ولا عياب ولا مشاح ولا مشاح بالتشديد. Now the messenger بخي بخيل. The messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was neither greedy nor was he avaricious nor was he slanderous nor was he obscene in his speech. Rather he was what? لين القلب لين الطبع سهل الخلق دائم البشر. نعم يتغافل عما لا يشتهي. The messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم wouldn't take interest in that which he did not desire. Meaning he used to stay away from that which did not concern him. And that's of course من حسن إسلام المرأة. نعم ولا يؤيس منه ولا يجيب فيه. He would not leave anybody who pleaded with him, who begged him for a solution to their problems. He would never leave them hopeless or disappointed. قد ترك نفسه من ثلاث. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم avoided three things. المراء أي الجدال. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم avoided argumentation. والإكبار arrogance. وما لا يعنيه. That which did not benefit him. Or that which did not concern him, I should say. Right? So, من حسن إسلام المرء تركوا ما لا يعنيه. And as we know, the كبر لا يدخل جنة من كان في قلبه مثقال ذرة من كبر. And as we know, المراء. Right, we have to leave that off. Right, the one who leaves off المراء حتى ولو كان محقا, then we'll have a palace built for him in paradise, as it comes in hadith. وترك الناس من ثلاث. Likewise, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he left the people from, or when it comes to dealing with the people, he left three characteristics, three traits. كان لا يذم أحدا. So there were three traits that he left related to himself, and that is the sifah, the description of argumentation, right, and the description of arrogance, and the description of buttoning himself into businesses that do not concern him. He left those three. He kept himself to himself, avoided that which did not concern him. He did not show arrogance, and likewise, he did not indulge in idle talk or idle argumentation. As for when it comes to his dealings with people, he left off three traits. كان لا يذم أحدا, meaning he would not blame people if they fell into a fault. He would not blame them. As you mentioned, Hadith of Anas, right? He would never say, why did you do something? لما فعلت كذا? When Anas would make a mistake or do something wrong. طيب. ولا يعيبه ولا يطلب عورته. Likewise, the Messenger of Allah would not find fault in people. He would not find fault in people or bring people down for the mistakes that they made. ولا يطلب عورتا, meaning he would not go into the privacy of his people, and he would not invade their privacy, and that's important. When it comes to people, as we know, the Messenger of Allah, he said, المسلم من سلم المسلمون من لسانه ويده, that the Muslim is the one whom other Muslims are safe from your hands and your tongue. And how do you do this? By don't look into their private affairs. طيب. Don't look into their private affairs. Likewise, if they fall foul with regards to something, try to overlook it. Try to come to an amicable solution. ادفع بالتي هي أحسن. Right? Likewise, safeguard yourself from entering into idle argumentation with them. Save yourself from arrogance. If you avoid arrogance, then you're not going to see yourself above other people. And if you don't see yourself above other people, you're not going to oppress them or transgress their حقوق or their rights or oppress them. صح. Likewise, leave off that which doesn't concern you. Yes, it's got nothing to do with me. It does not concern me. It's nothing to do with me. And of course, ما لا يعنيه is something which is of course في الشرع. Of course, الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر does not go against ما لا يعنيه, because that is from مما يعنيك. If you see a brother sinning, then as you know, the Messenger of Allah said, انصر حق ظالما ومظلوما. Right? Give victory to your brother or help your brother. Whether he is an oppressor or being oppressed. As for how when he is oppressing, of course, oppression is of three types. Oppression against Allah, or يعني تعدي على الله. Likewise, التعدي على الناس والتعدي على نفسك. طيب. So you now, when you see your brother sinning, he's committing ظلم, he's committing oppression, transgression against himself. And on the day of judgment, he's going to be, يعني he's going to come on the day of judgment that if he knows that you could have stopped him and he didn't stop him, he's going to blame you. Right? He's going to blame you. And so you need to, in this case, يعنيك, this is something which concerns you. So الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر does not contradict مما لا يعني. مما لا يعني أي في أمور الدنيا, right? Or في أمور in the matters pertaining to the world,
and the matters outside of the purvey of يعني باب الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر. So once you come with these things, eventually what's going to happen is people are going to be safe from your tongue and safe from your hands, and you become now a person who's come with حقيقة الإيمان, right, and has come with the completion of الإيمان. نعم. طيب. The hadith continues. ولا يتكلم إلا فيما رجع ثوابه. That the Messenger of Allah will only speak in that which he hoped to gain a reward for. And that's important. That a Muslim, remember, the Messenger of Allah said, كف عليك هذا يا نبي الله وإنا لم أخذون بما نتكلم به. As Mu'adh mentioned, فقال ثكلتك أمك يا معاذ وهل يكب الناس في النار على وجوههم وقال على مناخرهم إلا حصائد ألسنتهم. It's very important that the person takes into account what is he saying, because there's going to come a day where you're going to be taken into account, and it's going to be a day where people are going to be dragged by their tongue into the fire. Why? Because of the things that they sow, or what they reap from the things that they used to say in this world. So when you want to speak, speak that which you know you're going to get a reward, or that which you hope to get a reward in from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذَا تَكَلَّمَ أَطْرَقَ جُلَسَاؤُهُ كَأَنَّمَا عَلَى رُؤُسِهِمُ الطَّيْرِ. Here the Messenger of Allah had a presence. We mentioned this, the Messenger of Allah, he had an extremely strong presence. So when he would speak, and when he would talk, the companions would be sitting in silence as though there was a dove on their shoulders, or on their heads, right? على رؤوسهم, upon their heads, right? And this shows how still they would be, how attentive they would be, and how they would hang on every word that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, because every single letter the Messenger of Allah spoke is important, because the Messenger of Allah has given jami' al-kalim, small amounts of speech, little words, yet gems and gems of benefits condensed within those small words. And so it's important to pick up on every single word. So when the Messenger of Allah would speak, the companions would sit in silence, كأنما على رؤوسهم الطير, in clear attentiveness to what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was saying. فإذا سكت تكلم. When he would remain quiet, then the Messenger of Allah's companions would speak. لا يتنازعون عنده الحديث. When they were with the Messenger of Allah, they would not argue amongst one another. They would not raise their voices or enter into debates with each other in the presence of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As we know, the command of Allah in the Quran, لا ترفعوا أصواتكم فوق صوت النبي ولا تجهروا له بالقول كجهر بعضكم لبعض أن تحبط أعمالكم وأنتم لا تشعرون ومن تكلم عنده أنصتوا له حتى يفرغ. Likewise, when a person would speak from among them, they would all listen to him attentively until he finishes, meaning everybody would get an opportunity to speak. It wasn't like in our cafes today where people just speak, 100 men speaking in one go, you don't understand what's going on, and yeah, any conversation is flowing from one to another, and everybody's just talking in one go and nobody's giving another opportunity, the other the opportunity to speak. لا, that's not how it is. That's not how the gatherings of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم were. حديثهم عنده حديث أولهم. Likewise, when the topics that they would speak about would be the speech of the first person. So whatever the first person spoke about, that would be the topic of the conversation that gathering would speak on. طيب كان حديثهم عنده حديث أولهم. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he, as we mentioned in the previous lesson, he wouldn't come and change the topic. Rather, he would sit and speak in the same topic, or speak with the companions in that which they were speaking about. وكان يجلس عنده آخري المجلس عندما ينتهي, or he would sit in the place where the majlis would end. طيب يضحك مما يضحكون منه. He would laugh with that which they were laughing from. ويتعجب بما يتعجبون. Of course, ضحك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, we mentioned in a previous lesson that the laughter of the Messenger of Allah used to be mostly a smile. طيب ويتعجب بما يتعجبون به. Likewise, they would be amazed, the Messenger of Allah would be amazed from that which they were amazed with. ويصبر الغريب على الجفوة. Likewise, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would be patient when the stranger or someone from the badia, from the Bedouin, would come, and they would have in their speech an element of roughness, right? So sometimes you have, as we see in many instances in the Hadith al-Nabawi, where an Arabian Bedouin would come and he would speak into the Messenger of Allah in a manner that is what ghaliz, in a manner that is what coarse and strong, and that's of course based upon their upbringing. Yet the Messenger of Allah wouldn't put them down for that, rather the Messenger of Allah would listen to them attentively and be patient with them. Right? وَيَصْبِرُ الْغَرِيبِ عَلَى الْجَفْوَةِ فِي مَنْطِقِهِ وَمَسْأَلَتِهِ. You have some people who can't speak properly, right? They struggle with speech. They might have speech impediment. They might not be able to articulate themselves in the right way. طيب, yet the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم would be what? Would be patient with them, even though he was kind of an أصح الناس. He was the most eloquent of people, صلى الله عليه وسلم. Likewise, if people were to ask him questions, he would remain patient until they got everything out, right? He wouldn't pop in or jump in halfway through the person's query. He would let the person finish his query completely. Like, remember we said with what? The famous incident with Utbah ibn Rabi'ah in the Meccan period, when Utbah ibn Rabi'ah came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he offered him and spoke to him and he tried to get the Messenger of Allah to stop his da'wah, right? And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he waited until Abu al-Waleed صفى قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أأنصفت يا أبا الوليد أو أنتهي نعم أأنصفت يا أبا الوليد, have you completed, or have you brought everything out of your chest that you need to bring out of your chest, يا أبا الوليد? And then when Abu al-Waleed said yes, ثم بدأ, the Messenger of Allah began reciting Surah Fussilat until he reached قول الله تعالى فإن عرضوا فقل أنذرتكم صاعقة مثل صاعقة عاد وثمود. And then Utbah said حسبك, right? And then he came back to his people and then he said put it on my neck. جبنا Utbah, the Utbah has become a coward, right? And leave this person between him and the Arabs. فإن ظهر عليهم فعزه عزكم وملكه ملككم. If he becomes apparent and he becomes victorious over the Arabs, then his kingdom is your kingdom and his glory is your glory. And if they overcome him, فَهَذَا الَّذِي أَرَدْتُمْ, then that is what you had wanted, right? فَخَلُّ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ الْعَرَبِ. After he had heard the amazing speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Qur'an al-Kareem being recited by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as in Utbah bin Rabi'ah, he died a mushrik, نعم, on the day of Uhud, on the day of Badr. But you see here, the Messenger of Allah, the Shahid, the Mahal Shahid from this story, is the fact that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was what? Waiting for Utbah. Allow Utbah to finish completely. He didn't cut him in whilst he was giving his speech or his talk. Rather, he allowed him to completely finish his mas'ala and then confirmed from him, have you finished what you need to say? Has everything come out from your chest? And then after that, the Messenger of Allah gave his reply. حتى إن كان أصحابه لا يستجلبونهم, that sometimes the companions would be keen to attract them. ويقول إذا رأيتم طالب حاجة يطلبها فأرفدوه. So here the Sahaba, when they would see a غريب, a strange person coming to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, and they were trying to ask the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, and they had these problems in their speech or whatever it is that was denying or that was delaying them from being able to say what they need to say in a quick and concise manner, some of the Sahaba would say, if you see these people before they reach the Messenger of Allah, you take them and help them, because they didn't want to annoy the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, right? They didn't want to annoy the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam with these types of individuals, right? Who would have problems in articulating what they need to say to the Messenger of Allah in order to have their requests granted. طيب. And so what they would say to the Sahaba is that if you see any of these people on the route trying to meet the Messenger of Allah, intercept them, get there before, and try to get them to tell you, i.e. the Sahabi, their problems, and you deal with their problems, so that the Messenger of Allah doesn't have to deal with their problems. So this was mahabbatul sahaba lin nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the love and the desire to make things easy and keep things easy for the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. طيب, ولا يقبل الثناء الا من مكافئ, that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would only accept praise الا من مكافئ, except from somebody who understands how to give praise in moderation. طيب, ولا يقبل الثناء إلا من مكافئ, from somebody who number one understands how to give proper praise, i.e. he doesn't go beyond the limits of praise, number one, and number two, that this person, you've done something for them that allows you to that allows them to praise you. طيب, and it's not something that has been done out of the blue. The Messenger of Allah would only accept praise in terms of someone who is what? You've done something for them and then they praise you for that in return. That's acceptable. Not, and of course their praise is what? In moderation, meaning it's not going overboard. لا تطروني, as the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned in the hadith we took in the previous lesson. ولا يقبل الثناء إلا من مكافئ, أي بعد إعطاء النعمة إياه, فإن ثناءه حينئذ يكون مكافأة لا مدحا. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not want praise because praise. He did not like that. So someone would ask the Messenger of Allah for something. The Messenger of Allah would give and answer their request, right? And then because of that, mukafa'atan, out of congratulations, out of thanking the Messenger of Allah for that, they say some things of praise. Then that's a praise in moderation. And we'll see inshallah the hadith. There will be a hadith that will come later, inshallah, we'll see it. طيب, and we mentioned it previously, لا تطروني كما أطرت النصارى المسيح ابن مريم. هنا ولا يقطع على أحد حديثه حتى يجوز فيقطعه بنهي أو قيام. The Messenger of Allah will never interrupt somebody who was speaking unless he transgressed the limit. In that case, he would interrupt by either prohibiting him or by standing up. Right? So حتى يجوز أي يجوز الحد. So the Messenger of Allah will allow the person to finish his speech. However, if the person, as we mentioned in the previous hadith, right, if he يعني انتهك محارم الله, if he went beyond the right, the حقوق of Allah, he went beyond the laws of Allah and the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will be stopped. Either through the Messenger of Allah standing up and moving away, or the Messenger of Allah stopping him, prohibiting him from saying what he was saying. طيب, and so this hadith, remember we've spoken about it in terms of its chain and that it's weak. When we came across it the first time, and we said that the hadith, Tirmidhi did was, he took three parts of it and separated it into three different chapters, with all three chapters looking at it from three different angles. One chapter looking at the physical qualities of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one part of the hadith looking at the tawadhu, the humbleness of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and here we see again the general character and mode of conduct of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wallahu alam. The author then says, حدثنا محمد بن بشار قال حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن مهدي قال حدثنا سفيان الثوري عن محمد بن المنكدر قال سمعت جابر بن عبد الله يقول ما سئل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم شيئا قط فقال لا. That the Messenger of Allah would never ask something and he said no. As we know, we mentioned this previously, that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he was asked something, he would either give it or he would be someone who يعني, he would either have the answer, and if he didn't have the answer, he would reply back with al-maysuri min al-qawl, beautiful speech, soft speech, to soften the blow of the Messenger of Allah not being able to answer your query. But the Messenger of Allah wouldn't reply no, لم يقل لا. It was either yes, or he would appease them with speech that would allow them to go back. Even if they went back empty-handed and their request not being granted, they went back happiness with the speech of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave them, from that soft-spoken words and those comforting words that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would give. So the answer was never no. It was never a blunt no. It was either yes, you'll be given this, or the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would either give them something else, something better, or the Messenger of Allah would give them some comforting words that would allow them to go back still in a happy state, even if they never got what they initially requested. طيب, الله أعلم. The author then says, حدثنا عبد الله بن عمران أبو القاسم القرشي المكي قال حدثنا إبراهيم بن سعد عن ابن شهاب عن عبيد الله عن ابن عباس قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود الناس بالخير, وكان أجود ما يكون في شهر رمضان حتى ينسلخ فيأتيه جبريل فيعرض عليه القرآن, فإذا لقيه جبريل كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود بالخير من الريح المرسلة. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was the most generous of mankind in giving charity, and he was at his most charitable during the month of Ramadan, until the month of Ramadan will come to an end. And likewise, Jibreel will visit him during this month and present, and they would present the Quran and revise the Quran with each other. فَيَعْرِضُ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنِ, meaning they would revise the Quran with each other. The Messenger of Allah would recite the Quran upon Jibreel. And of course, in the last year of the Messenger of Allah's life, he did it twice. Now, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he would meet Jibreel, or when Jibreel would meet him, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was more generous in giving charity than a rih al-mursala, meaning wind that has been sent with showering rain. And so we see here again from the character of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that he was what? Kana jawadan. He was someone who was generous in giving charity, right? And his hand was open. طيب, in giving charity, and he was at his most charitable during the month of Ramadan, which is the month, of course, in which a person is fasting and worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and taking this opportunity when the doors of the heavens are open and the doors of the hellfires are shut, right, in order to increase in their goodness, right? And of course, this is an opportunity as well to take increasing worship and focusing on the Quran and turning attention towards the Quran al-Kareem. And as you see here, the Messenger of Allah would revise the Quran during this blessed month, the month in which the Quran was revealed, of course, with the angel Jibreel alayhi salam. But the mahal al-shahid here is that the Messenger of Allah كان أجود الناس. He was the most generous of mankind, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We've come across many hadith that the Messenger of Allah did not have much in terms of material possessions, yet despite that, he was still the most generous.
The author says, حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد قال حدثنا جعفر بن سليمان عن ثابت عن أنس قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يدخر شيئا. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم never stored anything for tomorrow. كان لا يدخر شيئا لغد. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم would not store anything for tomorrow. Of course, when we talk about storing here, we're talking about it, i.e. for himself. As for his family, we know in other hadith that have come that the Messenger of Allah would store enough for a month for his family, for his wives and for their children and for his family. طيب, that's of course for them. But for himself, he would never store anything, meaning he was what? His hand was open. He would give. He would give, give, give. Whatever he had, he would give. There wouldn't be anything left stored for tomorrow. That he would only do that for his family. And of course, his hadith is questionable in terms of isnad. And isnad revolves around Ja'far ibn Sulayman. طيب, and they say that this is from his manakir. This hadith itself specifically is from the Munkar reports of Ja'far ibn Sulayman. طيب, Tirmidhi rahimahullah, when he brought this hadith in his jami', he commented after it by saying, what, هذا حديث غريب. هذا حديث غريب, this is a strange hadith. وقد روى هذا الحديث وقد روي هذا الحديث عن جعفر بن سليمان عن ثابت عن النبي مرسلا. So there's اختلاف in terms of وصل عن إرسال, والراجح هو الإرسال للوصل. طيب, and so that's why some of the ulama mentioned that this hadith is what? معلل. نعم, معلل بالإرسال. And the reason for this إعلال is the presence of جعفر ابن سليمان, وله أحاديث منكرة. أحاديث منكرة. طيب, والله أعلم. As we mentioned also, that if the hadith was authentic, then it does not contradict the hadith that mentioned the Messenger of Allah would store his food, or would store food for and provisions for his wives and his family, right? Because this ادخار here is يعني لنفسه, كان لا يدخر شيء لنفسه لغد. طيب, والله أعلم.
The author says, حدثنا ثور بن موسى ابن أبي علقمة المديني قال حدثني أبي عن هشام بن سعد عن زيد بن أسلم عن أبيه أسلم بن عمر عن عمر بن الخطاب أن رجلا جاء إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فسأله أن يعطيه, فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, ما عندي شيء ولكن ابتع علي, فإذا جاءني شيء قضيته. فقال عمر, يا رسول الله, قد أعطيته فما كلفك الله ما لا تقدر عليه. فكره النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قول عمر, فقال رجل من الأنصار, يا رسول الله, أنفق ولا تخف من ذي العرش إقلالا. فتبسم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعرف في وجهه البشرى لقول الأنصاري, ثم قال, بهذا أمرت. And so this hadith, there are a number of points that come together that we mentioned previously in separate hadith. The first point is that a man came to the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم and he asked him to give him money. أن يعطيه مالا. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, ما عندي شيء. So the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was asked money. So that the people would come and ask him for حاجات, in terms of their needs. And so here, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, I don't have anything. So here, did the Messenger of Allah say, لا, لا. So we see an evidence, سمعت جابرا في الحديث, ما سئل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم شيئا قط, فقال لا. The Messenger of Allah was never asked anything. And he replied with no. It was never a case where he was asked with something and he said no. As you mentioned, he will either give it to you if he has it, and if he doesn't, then he'll give you an alternative or words of appeasement. And so here he said, I don't have anything. He's not able to give him money. However, he says, ولكن ابتع علي, however, buy on my neck, meaning buy and say the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم would pay the wealth for what I am buying, meaning buy in my name. So this person now would buy in the name of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the debt that you fall into, I will pay it. And so this is a solution that the Messenger of Allah has given the Sahabi who's asking him for money. And the Messenger of Allah is doing this to not let this individual go back empty-handed. طيب. فإذا جاءني شيء قضيته. And if then the person who you bought from comes to me, I will pay off the debt. فقال عمر. And then Umar said, يعني رفقا بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he's trying to make it easier upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? As we see in the previous hadith of Ali ibn Abi Talib, remember the Sahaba, what would they do? وَحَتَّى إِنْ كَانَ أَصْحَابُهُ لَيَسْتَجْلِبُونَهُمْ وَيَقُولُ إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ طَالِبَ حَاجَةٍ يَطْلُبُهَا فَأَرْفِدُوهُ. طيب طيب, meaning that the Sahaba, they didn't want to overburden the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so when they would see these people like that coming with questions like this, they would try to grab hold of the person before they get to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But here in this case, the person got to the Messenger of Allah before the Sahaba. And so when the Messenger of Allah told him to do what he said, or when the Messenger of Allah said that put it on my neck, put it on my name, put it on my tab, and I will pay for it, right? Even though the Messenger of Allah didn't have anything, Umar radiallahu anhu, he saw that this may overburden the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and so he said to him, Ya Rasulallah, qad atheituhu, you have given to him, فما كلفك الله ما لا تقدر عليه, meaning this person you've given to him before. So this means that this person come before and asked the Messenger of Allah for money, and the Messenger of Allah gave him. And so so Umar radiallahu anhu is saying to him, O Messenger of Allah, why are you overburdening yourself with something that you don't have? You didn't. It was not necessary for you to put the money, or to put his needs on your neck or on your tab. طيب, you didn't have to do that. طيب, you didn't have to put yourself in debt because of him. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Umar radiallahu anhu, out of his love for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did not want to overburden him, or he did not want any overburden put or any strain put on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَمَا كَلَّفَكَ اللَّهُ مَا لَا تَقْدِرُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not obliged upon you that which you don't have ability over. فَكَرِهَ النَّبِيُّ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam قَوْلُ Umar. But Umar, the Messenger of Allah, did not like the statement of Umar. The Messenger of Allah did not like the statement of Umar radiallahu anhu. فَقَالَ رَجُلٌ مِنَ الْأَنصَارِ. So a man from the Ansar said, Ya Rasulallah, anfiq, spend. Wa la takhaf, and do not fear, min dil arshi iqlala, do not fear from the owner of the throne, from the lord of the throne, iqlala, yani poverty or impoverishment. Fatabassama Rasulullah. So the Messenger of Allah became happy and smiled at the statement of the Ansari. Wa urifa fi wajhihi al-bishra, and it was known from the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, pleasure. From the look of his face, you can see clearly he was pleased with the words of the Ansar, and he was not pleased with the words of Umar. Even though Umar intended the words from a good place, Umar radiallahu anhu intended these words that he made from a good place, and that he didn't want to overburden the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we took in the previous hadith, kana ajwad an-nas, he was the most open and the most generous of people. And so it would not be befitting the status of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to reject this individual's request. It goes against his characteristics, it goes against his character, even if it might overburden him. And so we see here, the Ansari reminds the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, spend. For indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not leave you impoverished. He will not leave you put in poverty. فَتَبَسَّمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَعُرِفَ بِذَلِكَ عَلَيْهُ وَعُرِفَ فِي وَجْهِهِ الْبِشْرَى. You can see from his face pleasure and happiness radiating from his face. فَقَالَ, and so he said, بِهَذَا أُمِرْتُ. ثُمَّ قَالَ بِهَذَا أُمِرْتُ. Indeed, it is this that I have been commanded with. It is this that I have been commanded with. Right, كُلْ لَيْنًا مَعْهُمْ, be soft with them. إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ بِالْحَقِّ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا, give of glad tidings. Right, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, mercy to mankind. طيب, and so we see in this hadith that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, his benevolence and his karam and his jood is clear to see. However, this hadith itself, the isnad of it, has problems. For example, the presence of حدثني أبي, this أبي here is Musa, is Musa ibn أبي علقمة المدينة, هو مجهول, and he's the reason why the hadith has been weakened. And so the hadith, it's weak, but the معنى is sound. طيب, الله أعلم. The author then says, حدثنا علي بن حجر قال أخبرنا شريك النخعي عبد الله بن محمد بن عقيل عن ربيع بنت معوذ بن عفراء قالت أتيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بقناع من رطب وأجر زغب فأعطاني ملء كفه حليا وذهبا. That this companion of ربيع بنت معوذ بن عفراء, she came to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم with a tray filled with ripe dates and ujrin or zughbin. We came across it previously in the chapters on the food of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it's referring to essentially cucumbers, right? Cucumbers now. And so when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took this gift from Rubayyah binti Mu'awwidh ibn Athman رضي الله عنها وعن أبيها. The Messenger of Allah وسلم, he gave back that tray filled with trinkets and gold, filled with huli and dhahab. طيب, I mean, came across parts of this report in a previous hadith. والحديث فيه ضعف, there is weakness in the hadith due to the presence of Shariq ibn al-Qadhi, Shariq al-Qadhi, and Shariq al-Abdullah al-Nakhai al-Qadhi, and Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Aqil ibn Abi Talib. We came across these two individuals, spoken about them a number of times now in our traverse through this kitab. And some of the ulama, rahimahumullah, they render the hadith hasan, right? Shariq ibn Abdullah al-Qadhi and Nakhai and Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Aqil, they can be, you can potentially make tahseen, although some ulama criticized the matan as well. طيب. However, the shahid here again, the reason why it's been brought underneath this chapter is to show what the khuluq of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he was open-hearted, that he was his hand was open in terms of charity and giving people, right, and returning back the goodness that was given to him. So she came with a gift, and so he replied back with a gift. He didn't give the tray back empty-handed after taking the ripe dates and the cucumbers from the tray, rather he gave it back with food. And this is a culture that we have, alhamdulillah, in this community, right? If your neighbor gives you a tray filled with food, that you don't return back that tray empty-handed, you don't give it back empty, rather you give back their tray with yani gifts on it as well. طيب, wallahu a'lam. The author says, حدثنا علي بن خشرم وغير واحد قال حدثنا عيسى بن يونس عن هشام بن عروة عن أبيه عن عائشة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يقبل الهدية ويثيب عليها. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to accept gifts given to him and used to reward people with it, meaning when he would be given a gift, he would reward people with it by giving back to the people who gifted him. Right, and we mentioned this point in the previous hadith. However, this hadith, of course, from a isnad and a hadithist perspective, it's a very important hadith in that it's one of the hadith that Ad-Darqutni criticized Bukhari for bringing in his sahih, right? Because there's khilaf as to whether it's what mursal or mawsul. Right, and Bukhari Tirmidhi, they strengthen the view that the hadith is what? Mawsul, meaning it's connected to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and not mursal, not min marasil urwa. Whereas Ad-Darqutni criticized Al-Bukhari for bringing this report mursal and mawsul when the stronger report is that it is mursal min marasil urwa ibn Zubair. طيب. And this is one of the hadith that have been criticized by Ad-Darqutni in his kitab At-Tatabbu', in his famous kitab At-Tatabbu'. Of course, the matn of the hadith is sound, no doubt about it, 100%. In fact, mutawatir an Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he used to accept gifts, right? As we know, the Messenger of Allah, Al-Muhammad, do not accept sadaqah, but they accept hadaya, hadha mutawatir. And of course, Messenger of Allah would reward the people for the gifts that they would bring, and he would not leave them back empty-handed, right? So that's ma'roof. But in terms of the chain of narration itself, this specific chain, right, and the illah is based on Isa ibn Yunus ibn Abi Ishaq al-Sabi'i, right? He's the one who has the illah, and that there's khilaf as to whether the hadith is mursal or mawsul, right? Al-Bukhari rahimahullah rajaha, he chose and he brought in his sahih the hadith in its mawsul form, in its connected form, in its complete form, right? Meaning not mursal, and Ad-Darqutni criticized and said the mursal is what is more authentic, or the mursal is what is more correct. طيب, wallahu a'lam. And with that, the author concluded the chapter Bab ma jaa fi khuluq Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he moves on to the next chapter Bab ma jaa fi haya'i Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that which has come regarding the modesty and bashfulness of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is yani a very important point that the author rahimahullah mentioned and gave it a chapter title. He could have easily put it underneath the general character of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he spoke about in the previous chapter, but he specified Bab ma jaa fi haya'i Rasulullah and gave it extra importance and gave it a special section for itself or by itself, because of the fact that haya is very important. Al-haya min al-iman, haya is from al-iman, right? And likewise, we know that إِذَا لَن تَسْتَحِي فَصْنَعْ مَا شِئْتْ, right? If you don't show modesty, then do as you please. And as we know, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave great importance to al-haya and having this modesty and having this bashfulness. And that, of course, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was the epitome of haya. And of course, haya comes in different forms. Right? There are different types of modesty. There are different types of bashfulness. One of them is the modesty of showing graciousness and being kind and being kind-hearted and being soft-natured. That's min al-haya. Right, likewise, it also haya in terms of being a person who is devoted to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala And in that act of worship, you humble yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a complete humbling, right? And the reason why you humble is حياء من الله subhanahu wa ta'ala. فالحياء على أنواع الحياء من الله والحياء من الناس. Right? You have حياء from the people and you have حياء from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And then you have another type of حياء with regards to the person who you love, that you feel bashful for the one whom you love and that you feel shy from them and that you don't want to disappoint them. And of course, the one whom you love most is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Like, and then you love the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you love your family, you don't want to be, you don't want them to see you in a compromising position, the position that would make them disappointed in you. Likewise, you have the modesty of your own self. So al-haya'u min Allah wal-haya'u min al-nas. And then the haya of the nafs, the haya of a person's own soul, meaning that when you see yourself falling off the wayside, or falling off the train, or you see yourself falling short, right, you find that there is an element of shame in you, that you want to recover yourself, that you want to get back to that level that you were upon before, and that yearning and that desire, right, is something which it forms a part of your haya. And so, and of course, when a person feels this haya and this shame with themselves, and they're able to self-reflect first on their own haya, that will lead them to then improve on their haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and their haya from the rest of mankind. And that's why the author, because of the importance of the mas'alatul haya, wa annaha min al-iman, that is from the iman, and the author specifically dedicated to a hadith and a chapter for it, as we shall see inshallah ta'ala.
The author says, حدثنا محمود بن غيلان قال حدثنا أبو داود الطيالسي قال حدثنا شعبة عن قتالة قال سمعت عبد الله بن أبي عتبة يحدث عن أبي سعيد الخدري قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أشد حياء من العذراء في خدرها وكان إذا كره شيئا عرفناه في وجهه. And the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was more bashful than the virgin in her boudoir. And when he disapproved of something, when he hated something, when he disliked something, you would know that he disliked it from the expression on his face. طيب. The Messenger of Allah didn't need to speak for the companions to know that he disliked something. Right? And so, whilst the haya of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, this was a sifa of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was someone who was bashful, and his bashfulness compared to the bashfulness of a virgin in her boudoir when someone's coming to her to ask for her hand in marriage, or her father comes to seek permission if she wants to consent to being married off, right? That bashfulness, that shyness, the Messenger of Allah was even shyer and more bashful than that. طيب. And that's of course a sifa which is praiseworthy. طيب. In that the Messenger of Allah وسلم, had haya in the types of haya we mentioned. Of course, there are types of haya that are considered a manqasa, a deficiency. And that's, for example, someone who is too shy to ask for what they want. Or, for example, someone who مثلاً is in a state of seeking knowledge, right? الحياء is a madhamma. It's a bad thing when it prevents you from seeking knowledge, when it prevents you from asking questions to clarify, to seek clarification or something. These are that shyness which is not what's being spoken about here. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a presence about him anyway, right? That you could see when things would affect him negatively, or he didn't like something, you could see it on his face before he even began to speak, or before, without the need to speak. And so things would then change due to the facial expressions or the expressions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so whilst the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a person of haya, a person of modesty, right? His modesty is the modesty that is what? That is mahmud, that is praiseworthy. And his bashfulness is a bashfulness that is praiseworthy. And when it's used in the right place, then it is extremely praiseworthy. Extremely praiseworthy, and it's an extremely praiseworthy feature to have. But when used in the wrong situation, or when used in a situation where you're not supposed to come with haya, right? For example, مثلاً in the cases of seeking knowledge, and in the case of clarifying the matters of the religion, right? إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَحِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, right? So when it comes to these masa'id, right, in these kinds of situations, haya is not needed, or haya, it's not what's being wanted in these kinds of situations. But generally speaking, overall, haya is an extremely praiseworthy trait to have. And we mentioned some of the types of haya already in the previous slide. The author then says, حدثنا محمود بن غيلان قال حدثنا وكيع قال أخبرنا سفيان عن منصور عن موسى بن عبد الله بن يزيد الخطمي عن مولى لعائشة قالت قالت عائشة ما نظرت إلى فرج رسول الله أو قالت ما رأيت فرج رسول الله قط. So this hadith mentions that Aisha says that she never saw the private part of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that she never looked at the private part of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever. And this hadith, if it's authentic, and it's not authentic because of the fact that the Mawla of Aisha is unknown, the Mawla of Aisha is majhul, and there is no backup for this report. And in fact, some of the ulama mentioned this hadith is what mawdu', right? It can even reach the level of fabrication. طيب. However, if it was authentic, then you can see that the reason why it's being brought underneath this chapter is that the reason why she wouldn't look at the private part of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is haya'an. It's out of haya, out of modesty and bashfulness from him, and that the Messenger of Allah was also bashful and shyness when it comes to these matters as well. That's what the reason why the hadith has been brought under this chapter. However, this hadith is inauthentic. لا يثبت. It is an inauthentic hadith. Rather, it's close to being what? يعني من الموضوعات. طيب, if not, من الموضوعات. طيب. نعم. And with that, the author concluded the chapter باب ما جاء في حياء رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And so we'll stop here بإذن الله, as we have come to the end of this session. هذا والله أعلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.